Hello, welcome. Hi. Thank you all for coming tonight. We have very, very exciting evening here with Kathrin Anselm from Deliveroo. She's gonna tell you all about her journey as an entrepreneur. I shortly wanna tell you guys where you are right now. You are at GTEC, which is the German Tech Entrepreneurship Center. And we really try to foster entrepreneurship in all its ways possible. So we have an amazing lab here with right now 14 different startups, all in a tech background. And we really try to connect them with corporates and academics and have the corporates learn from the startups and the other way around. If you want to know more about us, then visit us on the tech center. And I hope you enjoy this lecture of Kathrin.
So before we start, I try to do this without a microphone for the simple reason that I have to manage my machine and I have to keep my speaking notes in the hand. I think juggling with the micro will be a little bit difficult. Back row people, can you? Oh, okay. So this is impressive. Thank you very much for having me. Thank you for joining tonight. Before we start, and that was actually a joke that was going back and forth between Luz and Benjamin, the guys from GTEC, and me, and I said, you always have entrepreneurs here. Why should I speak? I don't consider myself an entrepreneur, and you will learn why. And then they said, you know what? The journey is interesting, and people come to be inspired and to learn from other people's careers and journeys. So I hope I have found the right combination and mixture for you guys tonight. I've understood that you have various backgrounds, and let's get this journey started. Now, this is a picture of Berlin. It's winter 2009, Schlesische Straße, Kiez. My future business partner, Dirk, had just lured me from Munich to Berlin, first time. And he said, why don't you come to Berlin? I want to build a startup. I'm like, okay. I had by then a pretty unsuspicious career. I had started in management consulting, and then I moved on to ProSiebenSat.1 and was responsible for strategy for everything that's non-television. Yes, that was a small business, but it was interesting. And then I had a short stint at what is today Vodafone, where I built their video on demand business, sprucing up my business plan with what I fondly call adult entertainment films. So I did that for 2 years too. Not so unsuspicious anymore. But yeah, so that was my job and my career at that time. That's me approximately. Imagine blonde hair, me coming to Berlin. I literally fell out of my corporate job. I've seen couplings and business suits, me in Berlin. And that is an original picture. That was my accommodation for the first 6 weeks. So the startup was located in Schlesische Straße. And for the first 6 weeks, it was 2009, Airbnb wasn't that big in Berlin yet, and you actually had to look up on WG gesucht to find a room. So I said, well, there's a hostel around the corner, why not sleep at the hostel? And fancy schmancy, they had two rooms that you could book with a single bed, minus the flowers in the fruit basket, I've never seen them. So this is where I stayed for the first 6 weeks. And yes, and actually the business idea was to build an online dating service. Yeah. Our intention was to build the Parship for the Facebook generation. And fun fact, little did I know, I was weeks short of breaking up with my boyfriend, which actually came in quite handy because otherwise I could have never tested my own product. Welcome to Berlin. And fun fact, he's now my husband and he is sitting. So, this is basically 2009 when my internet startup career kicked off. I was either working alongside founders, I was succeeding to founders in a founders team, or I am or was supporting founders on a project basis. And actually, when I was preparing for that session, that was a good point in time to do a recap, and I thought it's actually quite funny what I did, right? And the combination of all this experience, the business models I work for, is basically the basis for anything I want to share with you tonight. And let's quickly run you through, because it's quite diverse. So first thing was the Parship for the Facebook generation called One to Like, and incidentally, we sold it after 12 months to Parship. So that was at least one exit on my CV. I didn't get rich on that, spoiler alert, but yeah, still. The second company where I joined the founder is Vodafone. It's a Berlin company, maybe one, a few of you have heard of it. It's one of the leading platforms in Europe to do crowd collaboration and creative crowdstorms. 80,000 creatives worldwide, they have around 400 contests under their belt, and they work with brands like Coca-Cola, Deutsche Bank, Victorinox. And for example, what they do is, and that's one of the projects I did with them, is we worked with Coca-Cola. Coca-Cola said, we want to have, want to innovate the Coca-Cola crate. This is very important for Germans, and we want to build it into something people want to put in their kitchen, like Nespresso capsules, and what was basically became trendy at that time. And that's the kind of creative crowdstorm Vodafone does. Then I thought it might be a good idea to join a rocket internet company, and I'm very glad to see some of my former colleagues here. I think that's a good sign. So I moved on to become the global COO of Wimdu, which was a rocket, was unfortunately, a rocket internet's try at building an apartment peer-to-peer rental platform competition to Airbnb. And then I moved on to Limango. That's actually a sort of a fun change because this company is the oldest in the club. It was founded in 2007. It's actually old internet Mittelstand by now. And I was there as their MD, responsible for operations, etc. Also a situation where for the first time I stepped in for a founder who left in a founder's team. And that was an interesting situation. I'm going to share some learnings about that as well later on. And this is the Blue Kangaroo, my most recent and probably the craziest ride I've ever had in my last 20 years. $1 billion in funding, Europe's fastest growing company. And I'm currently, and I have the big pleasure of heading the German business as their managing director, interim, for the next 6 months. And a couple of my lovely team members are here tonight as well. Very lucky to have you guys. So, if you look at my CV and the work I've done, especially in the past 10 years, I get quite often the question, what about yourself? Why don't you found a company? When are you going to launch your own startup? And the honest answer is, I'm not a founder. I don't consider myself this creative, always optimistic, this unbending optimism and kind of person who has this deep conviction that the idea they just work on will turn out okay. It's not me. So probably the title of the session would have probably be lessons of a non-founder, but let's see. And that's why this picture is quite befitting. I consider myself the partner in crime for a founder. That's what I learned at least over the past 9 years. I love to be around these kind of people. I love how their optimism and their energy and their risk-taking rubs off me. offer me. And I take a huge joy in seeing how what I'm good at, structure, focus, risk assessment, analysis, numbers, just complements most of these founder types in their visionary, creative setup. And it's from that angle and that perspective I love to share some of my learnings over the past 9 years with you tonight. I hope I've done a good mixture. Let's see if it's interesting for you, but let's jump right in. So, looking back, I think one of the major lessons I learned was about doing your personal due diligence and following your heart when you think about joining a startup as not the founder, but the one who is joining the founder or just coming on board a little bit later. And what I can share with you, if you're in a situation to think about that, either because you are being offered the opportunity to join a founder or you are a founder and you think about who's complementing you in the best way, a couple of questions are probably valuable to ask yourself. So, first of all, what I would do if I were you is check if I love the business idea. Does it make my heart sing? And am I in for the long run? When I'm sitting down with the founders, we have the impression that the vision, the values, and our ambitions fit. Can we both articulate what we like and appreciate about the other? That's a super helpful exercise. Do you have trust in each other, and do you have a clear view on who's doing what? That helps early on to define who's responsible for what. It will make you the better team. And I think one of the most important questions I sort of compiled for my personal due diligence is this a person I'm not only in for the long run, but can I see myself spending weekends and late nights and weeks at a time with this person without getting fed up? It's hard, but I would, just from my experience, advise you ask yourself these tough questions. Another perspective to look at an opportunity like this is to actually adopt the VC perspective. And what I mean with that is sit down and try to come up with your own assessment of the opportunity this business has. Is the market big enough? Even assuming a very, very small achievable market share, will you still be able to generate enough revenues that this business is going to be fun, or is it looking like it's going to be tedious and not even able to pay more than one person? And also sit down and do a so-called unit economics exercise. Think about how these look, and if they don't look good in the beginning, think about which drivers in the unit economics you can improve over time. And when the investment in the customer is going to pay off. Is anyone a little bit familiar with unit economics and how to calculate them? Okay, so there's a lot of resources on the internet, and if you are in a situation to assess with either your own business idea or the business idea of someone else, do it. I can only advise you to do that. So, another learning I found very helpful is to really be nitty gritty and look at the cap table. And here's a fun, not so fun story from one of the startups I worked for, I was co-heading. The cap table was, I wasn't experienced, I'm not a VC, I didn't know how to look at a cap table. And then I realized that the investors were a group of people living at Nikolaisee or in Dahlem. They were dentists, they were architects, they were professors at Universität der Künste. And I can tell you, I mean, these people are lovely, but it's so difficult to explain them how a risk business works and to keep them motivated and not look at their investment like they've put it in the bank and it yields X percent year on year. And the final learning in this, basically in this area here, is don't be blinded by valuations. Do the job because it makes your heart sing. Don't look at valuations. I was working for several companies. One was valued at, when I joined, they told me, 600 million company valuation, your share is easily already this and this, is valued at this and this. And it never turns up. I was working for so many startups. Exit is a It's a huge piece of luck. It seldomly happens, and you seldomly get rich. So you should do the job because it makes your heart sing, because it's interesting, because it's a learning opportunity, and the cash compensation is okay. So, first lesson. Let's move on. Time to align. Another learning I really sort of compiled over time, maybe also a little bit the hard way, was try and understand when you join, especially when you join a founder team, try and understand the unwritten rules and the implicit rules. What do I mean with that, or the implicit expectations? I'll give you an example. In one of my roles, I was succeeding to one of three founders in a long-standing founders team. And unwritten rules had been formed over 7 years. The three of friends have been working together. It was driven by their friendship, by the way they work together, then so the way how they challenge each other in key activities, how they communicated, for example, with employees. And I didn't know that. I stepped in and we never talked about it. And I started, for example, defining rules when it comes to communication with employees. And then at some point, a frustration built up and it really burst like a bubble at some point and we got into a huge fight. And it was frustrating for all of us because for me, it took me so much time to detect those rules. And the remaining co-founders never voiced their expectation or their disagreement, and it was frustrating for them as well. So my learning here is, the next time I join a standing founders team, I will make sure that we are very early on sit down, ideally with someone external, and make sure that we are very clear about expectations, about the unwritten rules and the implicit expectations. Is that a situation that sounds familiar with anyone of you? Okay, I see some nods. Good. So, and if the bubble bursts, or maybe it risks to burst, seek professional help. And what I mean with that is, tying back to that situation I had at that company, I should have voiced that immediately. Only like half a year later, I said to someone we brought in on a different topic, you know what, it would have been a good idea to have have gone you in early on and to work with you. So be it that you are in a situation of change management, that you are in a situation where you step into a founder team like I did, be it in a situation where you have troubles with your culture and you need a cultural change, or if you need growth coaching, my advice to you is don't hesitate, don't wait a day longer to get professional help. And what I would advise you, because I've done the search, either look in your network or ask people like me, it's okay to reach out, and look for people, that's my advice, who have already been in that situation. There are a lot of coaches out there, but my personal learning is work with someone who has been through this founding experience, who has built and scaled a company, who has been through a restructuring process, or who had to close down their company. It's character shaping, and the kind of experience they have gained will help you a lot. And just to name a few I've worked with, so there's, for example, Julia Dania in Berlin. She is the Gründertrainerin. So she works a lot with founders and does executive coaching, personal development, but also if founders get in a fight, and she sorts it out. Or Nicolai Ladiani, who is the one we brought in at Limango to help us with our growth process. I'm going to relate that a little bit later on. And also learning, don't hesitate to bring in the gray-haired guy. Even if he doesn't have startup experience, I've made a good experience with working with these alte Hasen at startups when it comes to change management or cultural change. Very helpful. Okay, so this is so far so good, the company is sort of still okay. The potential next step might be going separate ways. You will come, and I can only encourage you to be honest, you will come at some point in this situation to to a point where you feel like, oh God, I can't do this anymore. We are as a team, we can't work together anymore, it's super frustrating, we have to go separate ways. And I've been through that as well. So my learning here is, it's super tough to let go and to go and to step out of the founder's team, or in that, in my case, leave the founder alone who brought me in. But my learning is, it's worthwhile doing so. And the situation I have, the specific example I have for you is, I was co-leading a startup, and we had to go through a tough restructuring process, really, really tough. We had to close down our US business. This was really the dearest project to the founder. It was tough to let the people go, to close that business down. Will we ever be able to open up something in the US from Berlin? We got in such an extreme fight over this decision that we really had to go, we had to part, we had to go separate ways. And it took years, like a little bit like a marriage probably, or a huge breakup, it took years to get back together again. Now we're good friends and we do business together again. And funnily enough, he said, could you advise me on a project, because you're the only person I trust. And I think probably it's because we've gone through these really, really tough times. That was one learning, so it is okay to go. And you will be able to reconcile at some point. And I think my personal learning from that situation was as well, try to overcome your ego. Of course I would have loved to stay managing director of that company, but very honestly, after restructuring that company, and it's still, because of the restructuring, it's still here, it's still successful. The company wasn't able to afford two MDs, and the company wasn't that big anymore. So to be very honest, the company didn't need two managing directors. And I was looking at the situation, I thought, yes, I have a lot of skills that the founder doesn't have, but he's the founder, he should stay on, I should go. And I think it was tough, but I think that's a tiny piece that helped that the company survive. And in the end, it feels good, sort of, it feels like I've overcome my ego as well and just stepped out. So that was worthwhile as well. So, first section done, basically. A couple of learnings that all relate to you and your partner, your co-founder, or your managing director team. And I thought the second part might be well dedicated to a couple of practical learnings. I actually do see at every startup, no matter the age, no matter the size, and I'd love to share those as well with you. So, live your core values. You might have heard that oversighted statement like culture eats strategy for breakfast. I always get confused, is it breakfast, lunch, or dinner? Never mind. I think it was really old, has been around the block, but I think just looking at all the companies I've worked for and the cultural topics we have, I firmly believe that you cannot force a strategy upon a team or a company if the culture doesn't fit. It sounds like very simplistic, but I have to say, over and over again over the past 9 years, that's exactly what I learned. And what I want to encourage you is, there is not a later to define your culture. Try and do it as early on as possible. Yes, in small startups, the culture is very much the founder, but you will grow. And you will need to implement this set of values that's like glue that keeps the company together when you're not around all the time. And you need to make sure that these values are tangible, present, and that they are lived. And just to cite a really good example, and I have also not so good examples, and that really is a huge shout out to my lovely team at Deliveroo. At Deliveroo, I find we live values really well. So one of the values is never not be eating. We are in the food delivery business, and this is like the biblical, what's Heuschrecken in English? The biblical cricket plug. This team can eat. It's crazy. We are so crazy about food, and we try all day long new restaurants. And this is also supported by the company. And it makes that we are all passionate about food. It's so deeply ingrained in the culture. I mean, it sounds easy. It's food, right? But still, I have an example that contradicts that a little bit. Another value centers around, again, passion for the business, and that's the rider experience. And we use Facebook Workplace at Deliveroo, which is the first time for me, and it works really well to keep the company together and to set the tone. And our founder regularly works as a rider, and he always shares his experience, and he is so excited, like, this is crazy. This has evolved so much, and the product is so great, and I'm so proud of you. And you're like, okay, let's all work as a rider, right? This is so passionate and so deeply ingrained again, and that's something that this company does really well. Another value at Deliveroo is transparency. And I have to say, in 20 years' time, I've never worked for a company that truly lives to the value transparency. They share a wealth of data with everyone, from the CEO down to the intern. It's crazy. If that would leak at some point, competition would kill us. It never leaks. It's really funny. The more we share, the more professional and responsible people deal with the data, and it helps to build a true data-driven company. It's crazy. I'm so excited about that. And the last thing, what this company really does is, and something I want to share as well, I just mentioned it, Facebook Workplace is obviously something where you can spend a lot of time in self-presentation and just get your ideas out there. But the way the company uses Facebook Workplace as a driver of culture is incredible. It sets the tone of the tone. It is a constant source of challenge. Challenge each other is part of our value set, and there's constant competition. It's crazy, and that's something that I find really exciting. I've never seen that executed in that way. What I can also encourage you, or let me maybe give you another example. So I was working for another company, and again, this was around creating, well, that gives you a hint already. It was around creating, our value was create travel memories for our customers. We were in the travel business. But culture was probably not the strength of the founder. They tried to delegate it to HR, which is not a good idea. Either you live your culture as a founder or you don't succeed in doing so. And the second is, and that was really tangible for me, you can't build a culture that centers around creating travel memories for your customers if you limit the touch points your team has with the product, if you don't encourage them to travel. Of course, that sort of contradicts work time, but still there's a lot of things you can do, and that's something the company didn't do well. And it really, looking back, I have to say, I can list N examples where I think this happened exactly because ultimately we were not true to our culture. Let me just quickly check. Yeah, so don't delegate the responsibility for culture to your HR people, and don't accept an organization where it's done so. This is never a good idea. Okay, moving on to the next pet topic that is everywhere present in any company I'm working, and that is recruiting, do it right. There's so much great professional advice on how to do recruiting, but if I had to share my learnings for a small company, I would give you the following. If you look at the market today, unemployment rate is at a historic low. It's 4.8%. It's crazy. There's 82,000 open IT positions in Germany. There has never been a time where it was harder to find talent and to keep it on board. And no matter what, no matter which stage you are in, don't tell me you have no time to develop your team or that you don't have time for recruiting. It's the biggest mistake you can make. And I think a couple of learnings are really true for any stage or any company you're in. The first thing I always realize, no matter what, and I also see it today at Deliveroo, we do a lot of things really well. Recruiting, still have to improve a little bit. So be very, very clear about the skill set you look for. A lot of times I see like, people just say, oh God, I need to fill that position. But they don't look at the exact skill set they want. Take your time and sit down and think about the right person you want. Also, this is like a detective work. Think about where you find this person. It's a little bit like personas in marketing. Think about where these, the kind of talent you need in certain positions, where they live today, where they work right now, what they do in their pastime, how they look up job offers, would they respond to a Google ad or would they look on StepStone? Invest very, very early on in someone who is a professional recruiter. Don't neglect it, or at least invest in a well-designed playbook of how to do recruiting. Oftentimes, and that's also, and I don't think that's something that is sort of secret, oftentimes I realize, also at Deliveroo, I have such a great talent and such a great team, but their experience in recruiting, well, is limited. They've never been trained accordingly. And it starts not only with them, but also with more experienced employees with the question, what is actually the right question to ask the candidate to find out X, Y, Z? Well, if you don't know that, your recruiting won't yield the results you want to see. And another advice I can give you, or recommendation is, and I find it very weird that so few people do that. When you found the right person, and you've gone through interviews, and you've done a case study, please do me the favor and reach out and do reference calls. Call, ask your candidate, no matter which position, for reference, and try to look in your network for people who know this person. This is totally okay. Just asking politely for a reference. What I typically do is I have a set of sort of 10 questions, and I always ask the same question. If you ask 5 people and you sort of overlap the answers, you get a pretty solid idea of where the candidate stands in terms of strengths and weaknesses. And this has been so helpful to me in my recruiting. I've been doing recruiting for 20 years, so that's a record. And then the last topic I wanted to, the last recommendation I wanted to give you, I encourage you, because I do see it a lot in any company. There's a reason why there's a probation period. When you hire people, as good as your hiring might be, it can turn out that this person is not the right fit for the position. There is a reason why there's a probation period. Rather terminate a contract, do it fair. There is a fair way of doing it with feedback and rounds of improvement, but do it. I can tell you, in looking back at 20 years, I've never regret, as sad as it always has been, to terminate a contract. I've always regretted that I've waited too long. And that's something I want to really encourage you to do as well. Sounds a bit weird, but I think everyone as you wouldn't sit here because you sort of have an entrepreneurial mindset and you will be faced with that question. Make use of it. So, and then the last topic I wanted to cover with you, and just to give you some inspiration, is strategy planning. Don't tell me your company is too early, as an early stage, or too small, or you don't have time for planning. That's bullshit. You have to do this. It's not, there is no such thing as not having the time to plan. And just looking at the companies I've worked for, and again, that was small companies, large companies, no money, insolvency, shitloads of money. Actually, it boils down to always the same easy process or the easy steps, and they only need to be adjusted to the size and the stage and the culture of the company. And I want to quickly run you through, because again, fun fact, something that I do with my team at Deliveroo as well right now. So, I find it surprising. A lot of times when I'm working with companies, we look at each other and say, what's actually our North Star? What's our policy? The BHAG, the big, hairy, audacious goal. What's the BHAG they're striving for? What's the kind of company and the kind of business we want to build in the next 5 years? You can call it a vision, you can call it a BHAG, you can call it a North Star. But do it. Sit down and define it. Make it really specific, make it tangible, make it exciting, and make it really, really tough to reach. A good BHAG or a good vision or a good North Star is the one that constantly pushes you out of the comfort zone. Right? So that's the first thing you should have on your piece of strategy paper. The second topic you need to cover, or I would recommend you to cover, is have your value proposition clear. And I actually like the comment, even from an old version of adding these value propositions, but I like the way how they did it. The value proposition answers the question of what kind of problem do I actually solve? And it's really surprising of how often I sort of have the pleasure of sitting down with people who have a business idea, and I ask them, what's actually the problem you're solving with that? And then there's an awkward silence. It happens more often than not. And this is why I really want to point this out again. Sit down and think about your value proposition. What's the kind of problem I'm going to solve? What's the need I have identified? What is my customer? Who's actually needing the solution to the problem I've identified? What's my approach to this? And who's my And that's it's a little bit sanitized, but that's just because I always think it's sort of, to have a visual idea is sort of helpful to retain the inspiration. So what we have started at some point at Limango, and I actually do that right now with my delivery team, is compile the BHAG, the value proposition, and the target for the next 12 months, for example. We want to grow by X percent, and we want to launch new markets, and we want to be, in Limango's case, the preferred European suppliers for moms and families out there. It's sort of a mixture, just to give you an idea. That's what we're doing. And especially the growth target will give you some guidance on what to do next. You need to sit down and ask yourself, if I want to grow by 25 or 50 or 100%, what are my key areas where I can really make sure that this growth happens? And for example, I call them strategic levers. And in Limango's case, we realized that in order to achieve our target for the next 12 months, we had identified 5 strategic areas. It was about the great offering, the user experience, a best price promise that was pretty tough to implement, but we realized that this was essential to growth, brand work, and we had to cut costs substantially. In Deliveroo's case, and that's, again, no secret because all of the food companies or delivery companies work like this, the key priorities will center around selection. The more selection you have on the platform, the more restaurants are out there, the better. This will drive growth. Probably it's the biggest lever. Great service and price. Sounds simple, but I realized sitting down with my team at Limango or Deliveroo, just by writing down and just nailing those priorities to a wall makes them visible. And everyone starts thinking about, is actually what I'm doing the next 12 weeks helping on that is that sort of something that is tied to that strategic lever, and will it ultimately result in growth? And doing this exercise alone helps really a lot. So in Limango's case, this is a little bit new. Is anyone familiar of you with OKRs? At Limango we don't do OKRs by the book. At Deliveroo, we just start with it. But basically we're saying we have certain growth targets, and we know where our strategic levers are. What are we going to do the next 12 weeks? And then I was sitting down with my management team at Deliveroo, and then I said, it was actually a sort of building a matrix that looks a little bit like that. And I said, probably the, like, for example, my colleague who's responsible for signing up the restaurants, the next 12 weeks you'll probably be able to do maybe three things, probably not four. What are the three objectives? What are the three key projects you're going to tackle with what specific target, with what specific outcome that make you feel most confident about reaching that first target? And it sounds easy. We've been sitting hours at sort of poring over that and discussing the answer to that question. And I did that with Chiro today, well, his area. And it is, it's not an, not a, not an easy exercise, but in the end, feedback is, okay, wow, now I'm so much clearer on what I'm going to do the next 12 weeks. And that is in a situation where they get, all of us get overwhelmed by emails and stuff, and headquarters is asking for this and that. Just by writing down for each one of them, what are the three objectives and with what results you're going to work on the next 12 weeks, makes us a little bit relaxed. We start looking at our inbox in a different way. We start filtering, is that relevant? Is that sort of helping me in my 12-week target? Not so much, let's push it out to tomorrow and push back, for example, on any headquarter request. And this is a little bit of a dry exercise here, but I hope I get the message across. It's so helpful to do that and to break this down into tangible results, to set you a focus for 12 weeks, like the OKR methodology or management by objectives explains. It's really worthwhile working in this kind of framework. And that's just basically a little bit of the visualization of how we actually work, we operationalize this whole planning. So we have now a spreadsheet. We've written down all our objectives and key results. And I'm going to share that on Friday with the whole team. It's the first time, despite the fact that we have so much data and so much targets, the first time that the entire team will know what management and everyone else is going to work on the next 12 weeks. And that's providing transparency and also fostering a culture of starting to challenge each other. Because this is what we're going to review each month. It's not looking at order volume and the usual KPIs. It's about, hey, Chiro, your commitment was to work on this project because that's tying back to growth. Where do you stand? And we encourage also questions from other departments saying, hey, Chiro, can we help you? Or why is this not working out? Is there a way of changing that? And I'm really looking forward to see how this turns out. I know from Nimango it was super, it was a game changer, and it really helped us to become faster. So, last slide. I hope you're still with me. At least for me, I find it always really interesting to see what people read or which podcast they listen to. This is old stuff. It's not 2019. It's old for goodie. I'm quickly going through because that's something I find helpful. Mastering the Rockefeller Habits and Scale to Growth is a strategy framework that we have been working with the guy who we brought in as an external professional to support us at Nimango. There are many strategy frameworks out there. This is one I can recommend. It worked for us at Nimango. It really changed the game in terms of strategy planning. And it's fun to read. It has really good examples from tech companies and internet companies. So that's a good one. The Lean Startup, I guess everyone knows that, so I don't need to mention it. I still find that very helpful. And we've applied some of the principles actually at Windu, the rocket internet company, and I thought that was mind-blowing just to see how MVP, also at Nimango, MVP thinking changes the way we work. And then two books are dear to my heart because they are helped me in personal development. So one is The Happiness Advantage. Not surprisingly, if you think about what I told you about not being a founder, I tend to be a little bit of a risk-averse person and a little bit of a pessimistic person. And sometimes I do see the glass half empty instead of half full. And I started to read this because I didn't want to feel unhappy in the end. And I realized that when I'm unhappy, this will sort of influence my team as well. And this book exactly tells you, in a nutshell, happiness is something you can train. You can change your mindset to see the good thing in life. And it tells you how this affects your team and how it makes you a better manager. So, huge recommendation. And the last one, that is very specific to me being a perfectionist and always struggling to do everything 150%. Old one, I think it's from 2001, 7 Habits of Highly Effective People. It's helpful in the professional context. It's also helpful for my personal life, thinking about what you can influence, where you want to go. That's like really my personal treasure chest. And that's it for tonight. I hope that was sort of a little bit of everything. I hope that was of interest to you. It was a little bit inspiring. And I thank you for just listening to me and be attentive. I hope that was interesting. Thank you very much.
Guys, we have time now for a Q&A, so everybody who wants to ask questions, just go ahead. Then after this, bar is open for beer and coffee, and you can all hang out here until 8, and then I have to kick you out. But first, maybe who has some questions? Or
so, what's your name?
I'm Ben.
Okay.
What would be your advice to someone with a corporate background in convincing founder or a small startup to hire?
Oh, that's a good one. So did everyone get the question?
No.
So Terry?
Yes.
Asked, how do you convince a founder or a startup to hire you being a corporate person? So I was actually in the situation, remember the dating platform? So I came to Berlin and my co-founder, or the one who had the idea, said, I like you, Kathrin, and it's all good, but actually, you have no street credibility at all. You're like, you're a corporate. It was, fair enough, it was 2009, 2010, so I think times have changed. I think, so how to answer your question. I would probably self-confidently say, if we're 2019, right? If by now, founder hasn't understood that corporate doesn't mean inflexible or not fit to do a startup, then he or she has not understood some fundamental stuff. I think it's worthwhile looking out for the right founder will see your potential and your skill set and will not look at your tag as a corporate. So in a nutshell, I would say, continue looking, continue reaching out, connecting. That's one way of doing it. If you, I don't know if that is something that you can do in your professional or in your personal setup, but I think it helps to just, if you can, volunteer and say, you know what, I just want to come here and learn. If you take me on for 6 weeks, 2 months or 3 months, if that's something you can do, that's probably a really good idea. I mean, startup, no money, skill set for free. Hello, that's something you can try. And I would start really connecting at events like this. Probably something that you might get to start. Does that make sense? Yeah. What's your name?
Hi. As a woman, how did you find being in managerial positions in the startup and tech scene?
It feels still quite lonely. It turns out that actually I've always been the only woman in the management team. You guys need to change that. Yes, it's a little bit lonely. It's a little bit awkward if like for example, the all boys founder team I joined, they used to do like offsites in the winter in the south of Germany with snow, and then they have a tradition of going out in the snow naked, and then they looked at each other really often and say, oh God, I can't do that anymore. I can do something else in the meanwhile. So what I'm trying to say is, yeah, it feels lonely because, okay, I'm not the soccer person. I enjoy talking about something else, but if I'm like out with the boys, they will, soccer is probably a big topic, so that feels lonely. I have to say, I do read oftentimes in Deutsche Startups or Gründerszene or even TechCrunch that there is a lot of sexism, sexual harassment in startups. I've never noticed that. I was lucky. I have, in 20 years, no matter which position, I've always a situation where I say, actually, I've been really sexually harassed. But funnily enough, it's not my co-workers in my startup or don't get offended IT people, but often the biggest potential I see here with male IT talent. But it always happened, funnily enough, with people from the corporate side. So, and probably the area where I've experienced it a little bit was, to be very honest, male tech team, female product owner. Oh God. So that was I have various situations where I really had to step in and make it very clear that because it's there's a woman here, you should take her serious as well. So that's my experience. Is that what's yours? Same
I'm yet or? yeah, I think I'm yet to discover that. Mm-hmm. I was asking more in terms of like being in upper management from running a company, but maybe a bit further, how do you feel you can add as a woman into
yeah.
these situations, especially like you said, in this boys founder?
Let me think what my male colleagues say. So I think what consistently comes back is, and in a good way, the tone of voice changes. It becomes a little bit less aggressive, it becomes more like compromise-oriented. I think that, and that's something I had to learn as well, and just to really be very clear about not interrupting me. Yes, I do all the time. And get, you know, let me finish my sentence. So that had, I've seen that as a positive impact. Start not interrupting each other, just learning to listen a little bit. And I think the biggest impact I see or I hear from my female co-workers or my female employees or is, and that makes me very happy, is that the minute a woman is in top management, out of a sudden it becomes possible. There's a career step to be made, and I've seen so much energy being liberated just by the fact that I was there, at least like judging from the feedback I got. So I feel like, yes, it is still a little bit lonely, and I would also deliver. We're 13 markets, two are run by women, Spain and Germany. But I feel that just being there and getting myself heard and just following my management style and making clear that the way I manage a company or the way I take decisions is as valuable as my male co-worker would do it, opens up for all the female staff a new position, a new perspective, and that motivates me, and I think that's the best way to go forward, to be a role model. Yes. What's your name?
My name is Ivan. Thanks a lot for sharing and squeezing so many experiences and personal situations in this short round. I will try to squeeze two questions into
yes.
my one slot. So the first part of that, you mentioned briefly about the strategy and culture and how it will be difficult to impose a strategy where the culture doesn't fit. If you could dive a little bit deeper into that part, how you understand that saying. And also the second part is when you see as a leader, as a founder, when you see this as the culture actually doesn't work, for example, be bold, be brave, be egoless, and some things are working, people are not actually living these values. What would you do? Is there a script or a scenario, like how would you approach the situation to change it, that not also to introduce something like when people don't understand what is happening and why this change is being imposed, like how would you approach this changing of the culture and improving this culture?
I mean, it's a spoiler alert, it's a long process, mm-hmm. but some learnings I've had or made. So at Limango, for example, I think that's something I can share as well. We had a set of values that have been around for a very long time, since the beginning of the company. I joined when the company was 7 years old. And then living the values had sort of gotten a little embarrassing. Some of them were very present, and some of them were really hard to implement. And I think that the best thing we did was just starting a conversation, right? Again, felt very awkward. Okay, we have cultural discussion today, and whatever. And that, again, we had external help. Mm-hmm. I think that's a good idea to bring someone in, someone mutual with authority. And then we realized that certain values were just making a lot of the people in the company uncomfortable. To the point where they said, I haven't signed up for this.
Okay.
Let's say in Nimango's case was the biggest, the top core value is we are making the mom's needs, because they are still the core target group, the mom's needs in shopping for their kids our top priority. And at some point you realize that people say, what? Like, I'm doing accounting. I'm not actually, why should I identify with the needs of the mom? And that's totally sad feedback, but it's important. And so we first of all, we really had discussions and workshops and were able to carve out certain values that simply didn't work. And that didn't work because people just hate them. So this is, I didn't sign up for that, or we don't do this. This is just, just saying so, but we don't live it. Mm-hmm. And after we had been able to identify what the problem was, we started working on them. And working meant some of them were completely reformulated, mm-hmm. and then you have to just let them go, right? And you say, okay, that's times have changed. Doesn't mean the end of the company, because some people are just very afraid then of change. So we reformulated some of them, and some of them we just simply let go. And we started really, and that's tough, we started being honest to ourselves and said, if we believe in those values, we need to start not only putting them on a wall and a poster, we need to start executing on them. And the first thing we did sounds very simple, but it was tough, a tough job. We started integrating the values in our recruiting process. And that sparked a huge discussion about what? We're not going to hire people because they don't fit our culture. Can we afford that? Yes, most of the time, actually, you feel like, shit, I can't afford that. I just need this talent. But if you don't do this and you're not consistent, it won't work. So that's something, so it's second question. I think I can answer. And to your first question, let me use the example of data transparency and data education, as one of my former colleagues just put it. If your growth in a company or your strategy relies on a substantial data savviness in the company, and you want to really instill number drivenness and analytics, and your strategy and your strategic targets are made out of numbers, you can't just not give people access to data. And I've seen it over and over again. Oh God, no, I can't share that. At Deliveroo, for example, people, like nearly everyone, knows any value from order volume down to EBITDA. That is very uncommon. And I have to say, it makes me feel a little bit uncomfortable as well. But that's the exact kind of approach, because no one can hide that they didn't have access to the data and was not able to decide data-driven on actions and to work on a strategy that is centered around precise targets.
Mm-hmm.
Does that answer your question?
Yeah. Thanks.
Okay, maybe if we start here. What's your name?
Hi, I'm Jovan. And it's kind of a question based on what you just said around culture and hiring. And I feel a little late. Apologies. I don't think you said this, but maybe. If you've made a bad hiring decision at some point,
yeah,
and how you recovered from that, what the reasons were. Something like that's happened to me personally recently in my startup, and that's what I'm interested in hearing about that.
Recovered or how I dealt with it.
Okay. Yeah.
Letting people go is hard,
yeah,
to be very honest. It sounds like I do it all the time, no. And I really have had a tough situation. I joined a company and I was responsible for HR. And the first job I got from the founder was like, oh God, we really need to execute today on letting someone go. And I said, okay, well, that probably has been thought through and that was a fair process. And I was sitting down with that lady. And I had taken over the position of someone, I was the CEO of the company, and I'd taken the role over from someone who moved to another role, and then he came furiously to my desk in the afternoon and said, you know what, Kathrin? I supported your hiring, and what you do on your first day is you just fire my girlfriend. And I was crying, I was really crying. And that taught me a very, very tough lesson. And I still tend to cry. I hate terminating contracts. But the way, what I realized for myself is if I decide on a termination of a contract, I do this out of deep conviction. I think that's the first thing you need to make sure for yourself. And I really want to be sort of strict with myself. When I'm deciding for a termination of a contract, I want to make sure that this is a fair process, and so far as that the person in case has gotten regular feedbacks, that there was like really people sitting down and thinking hard about the skill set and how about maybe moving this person to another role in the company. And oftentimes or not, I find that this has never been done and you just let people go, right? And this is something I feel is really important to be able to deal with it and to do it basically for yourself. You can look at yourself in the mirror the next morning. That's one part, and if I look at the executional standpoint, again, I can only say, I don't know about your experience, but mine is you realize pretty early on if the hire in the role matches or not. And most of the time you just fear the next step because you fear the rehiring, because you fear the sitting down with that person, maybe the anger, the tears. But don't postpone it, just do it. And really execute it right away. So that's the second part of dealing with it. And the third part maybe is, and that's the hardest part I found, if it's someone who has been long with the company or has an exposed position, I'm always, or we are always worried how this will look with the team, how the reactions of the team will be. And I found that it's hard, but I found the most rewarding or the best way to do this is to be very outspoken and honest. And my learning over time was that an organization in itself is surprisingly competitive and has most of the time, so I was very surprised in the end, has most of the time a pretty clear view about the person in case. If they are very honest, they will tell you, it's not the best hire we had. And I think as long as you're honest and you make your decision very clear, it is okay to say, we are a performance-driven team and we want the best talent here because this is what we have, what we started and what we came here for. And that's my experience. So this sort of combination of these factors.
Mm-hmm.
And we had some questions here, I think. Yes.
I had a question.
What's your name?
Mila.
Mila.
Yeah. have a question rather regarding your career.
Yeah.
You described yourself as a rather pessimistic person, but how did you make the decision or your motivation leaving the corporate world and jumping into the startup scene back then?
Oh yeah, there is a glossy story to it and a very honest answer.
So.
And I'm looking back, I'm so glad this was the first, but also the last time someone else took that decision for me. I was fired. And I was fired from a pretty high fly job at ProSiebenSat.1, and I was 33, and I thought, oh my God, my career has ended. No one's going to be hiring me. That's me. Very silly. The reason why that happened was, just not going into the details, but I think it was a combination of, it was my first MD job. I was like, I was calling my parents and saying, thank you for making this possible. Very dramatic. I was so hyped and so over-motivated, and I was, on the other hand, I think I was a pain in the neck for the I joined a startup, ProSiebenSat.1 had acquired the firm at that time, very early on, not a good idea, deeply integrated in the corporate world, not a good idea. And I was working with a founders team who actually, maybe for a reason, regarded me as, oh, the controlling person from the concern, maybe. And also, I think they had, this was a pretty attractive deal for them. I think getting a lot of money early on in that situation doesn't necessarily make that you fight no matter what for your company. I was fighting no matter what, and I was looking at the phones like, why not put you going home at 6 in the evening? And I think we're really unnerved by each other. And at some point, ProSiebenSat.1 said, it doesn't make sense. Let's terminate your contract. I said, good deal. But yes, I was shattered. And then someone took the decision for me, and I'm so glad. This is probably one of the best things that happened in my career. Because I had always mused, I'm the risk-averse person, I always mused about how would that be to step out of Munich, out of this consulting strategy environment, everyone at the age of 30 thinking about silver engraved, like, spoons, knives, and taking over the tiny little house at Lake Tegernsee from their parents. How do I get out there, right? And maybe is there a career in freelancing and in consulting? I would have never taken that decision, and that was my entry in the startup world. That was in summer 2009, in Parship.
Thanks for sharing.
Yeah.
Hi, thank you very much. My name is Anna, and I have the following question. We've been talking a lot about company values and how it's important is. Maybe you had a situation, when do you draw this line that you decide not to join the company? On the very early introduction to interviewing process stage when you understand that maybe there's another values. Have you had this? That the business idea is amazing, it's very interesting, everything sounds so good, but when you talk to the people and you ask what their values is, have you had this that you understand it's not yours from this company?
Yeah, to be very honest, I didn't, and that ties back to this idea of doing your personal due diligence. Probably I had it more than once, but I didn't listen to myself, and I didn't admit it to myself because I was so blinded by cool grant, fancy title, maybe a huge cash compensation or tiny salary and crazy valuation, that I didn't pay enough attention in the past. I don't regret any of the strategies or the career moves I made because they were all so worthwhile. But looking back, I could have taken more often the honest decision, no, this is not me. That's not me, this is not my playground, that's not my culture. And I think I did it once where I simply felt exactly like what I said in the beginning. I didn't, so my marriage witness, she's actually really good advice. She said to me, you know what, if you don't know, just picture yourself going to work, sitting with them in an office, spending weeks and nights and weekends with them. How does that make you feel? It's like an esoteric exercise, so I've all structured them. But that, that was good. And that was the first time I realized it's okay to walk away and to let the fancy title and the brand and just let it go. And in hindsight, it's hard to judge, right? But just looking back, I think it was the right decision. And learning is I should take it more often. That's why I put it out to you. Make it part of your personal due diligence.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, what's your name?
Hi, I'm Anastasia. So you mentioned your consulting background, and I'm wondering how would you recommend, or how it was your experience working with different founders? Were the ones that had a consulting background more were they more successful? Would you recommend doing that before actually founding the company? And how did it help you in being like complementing the founder?
So yes, I have to say that the bigger part of the founders I work with have a consulting background. I mean, there are many ex-consultants by now. It was, I have to say, mid-2000 or end of 2000, when I came to Berlin, my background was still pretty unusual, consulting and corporate, moving into the startup world. That was just the beginning when people at WHO or Research Winkel, like all those universities, and then went to BCG, and then started their company. I would tend to say that this background, especially the toolkit you require, the structure, the analytics, thinking and hypothesis, is really helpful. I would never ever not be part of the consulting work. This is a toolkit I still use a lot today. So I think that is that probably is part of the success or of a successful skill set for a founder. One of the companies I've worked with, Gervotto actually, I mean, if I look at Bastian, is so the contrary of everything. He's like the creative, he's so visionary, it's crazy. No consulting background here. Yes, you could argue it's not a billion tech company, right? Is that necessary? Probably not. But this is, he's for me an example of being the total opposite and succeeding and managing a company in a very competitive and difficult environment. But yes, I mean, I think I do see a pattern here, and probably a good person or even a better person to ask that question is a business angel or a VC who sees a lot of, even more than I do, and who could probably answer that question even better. But from my experience, yes, it is helpful. And coming back to your to the second part of your question, how do I complement them? In that area, no, because that is overlapping skill set. I do have like co's that have consulting background as well. At the Mango, funny enough, there's one Arthur D. Little doesn't exist anymore. So one BCG, and then me, Oliver Wannemann. But this is like the base skill set is overlapping, but there's a very different skill set that complements that. And so if you reduce it to the consulting part, there would be just an overlap of skill set. There would be no complement. It's something else. Does it make sense? Mm-hmm. Yes. Okay.
I've never
had a strategy of selecting a mentor. I was always a little bit too shy. I thought, sort of when I was mid-2000, or like I started crazy. I started working in 1998, really long time ago. But this was sort of in between 1998 and late 2000. That was probably the time when I would have needed most a mentor. Again, to be very honest, I was not really like pushing it out there. I felt like, oh, can I approach people? Mentoring wasn't that still that regular and that normal and that big in Germany at that point in time. And it felt and LinkedIn wasn't that predominant as well. So no, I didn't have a strategy. Somewhat again, another decision someone else took for me. I was at that company where I sold adult entertainment movies for video demand. And the only other women sort of remotely in management was like a fantastic woman. She was from Morgan Stanley, she was heading the investor relations department, and she was the coolest cookie on planet Earth. I was so admiring her. And she was always like coming to work, like very female, fully dressed up, giving a shit, sitting down with Providence and Apex and Goldman Sachs. And at some point she came to me and said, you know what, Kathrin, let's have a chat. And she started informal mentoring for me. And I actually wrote her like a year ago and said, I'm getting so many questions about mentoring today, and I'm always, you know, well, Inza, I always come back to you. And she was crying, she was really, she really touched. She said, really? I said, yeah, that you started it. So today, I try to build my network and just ask people, could you help me? Helping is, I don't know, maybe I didn't dare to ask, but now I'm asking, help is pouring in. It's great. Just so my advice would be, think about the kind of mentoring you want or you need, the kind of advice you're seeking or the areas you want to improve, and then just ask. Ask for help. Probably you reach out to three people and one will answer and be, you know, will take the time. I do it myself. I do it like I have typically women, sometimes also men, but more women approach me. I sometimes do that with employees, and I do it informally in my network. Because I firmly believe, I think Madeleine Albright said that women who don't support each other go to hell. That's true. I firmly believe it, so I try to squeeze it in at whatever time I can do, not a lot. Yes. So, Luz, actually, you are the master of the time, right? So you
have
well, it's 7:29, by the way. So,
can you keep on doing the questions, or
how do you feel about wrapping this up? If there are any more questions, I think.
I'm
what's your name?
Celia.
Celia.
I'm obviously international by accent, and I'm very inspired by women like you. So obviously you're a unicorn of all generations, and I would like to, you know, ask you, what would you advise for like women like me in order to step into such an important role as you had over the years?
Push yourself out of comfort. It really like sounds like it's motivational, but it's like that. Push yourself out of the comfort zone. If someone senior asks you, would you be up to do this? The speech, the mentoring, the project, the role. Do your personal due diligence, and if it feels exciting but you're afraid, do it. That's the best advice I can give. And I can tell you, I took a lot of decisions like that, and there's always a part of fear in them, still after 20 years. But looking back, as I prepared for tonight, I'm like, this is crazy. I've done so much stuff, and I always feel like, oh God, I'm not able to do this. And that's probably it, because something is stronger that drives me out of my comfort zone than my fear. So that's
the advice. Yes. Yeah, to add that one more, maybe passion is needed. Once you are passionate, passion is the key for the happiness. So end of the day, they will be very happy. So they can do whatever they want to do. So passion is needed.
Mm-hmm.
Without passion,
I think like courage, passion,
I think also, I think what drives me still, and look at my CV, I'm not the one who's staying with a company for 10 years. And that can be sometimes, people sometimes do see this as problematic. Why is she like moving along and changing jobs? I was always driven by the desire to learn. I find working, despite all stuff that makes me afraid and where I think, oh God, will I ever be able to succeed? There's something that always, so there's some desire to learn always around. And I think working is a little bit like traveling. There's so much to discover out there. And for example, now at Deliveroo, I will cry when I have to leave this team. It's an interim job. And it makes me really sad to leave them at some point, but then it feels like, wow, the canvas is blank again. What's next? What's next? What company, which business model, which learning opportunity is next? And I think that's something that drives me as well, and that's something, wanting to learn and be curious is definitely helpful.
I think that's perfect to end.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.